All right, so it's great to be here at Enclosure. We've had a couple of great talks already, and I'm looking forward to the rest of the day. A quick shout out to the Bangalore Closure Meetup group before I begin. The organizers there do a great job of keeping it going. I'm not as regular an attendee as I'd like, but the few sessions that I've attended, I've really enjoyed. So yeah, getting on with it. My talk's called Composable Data Pipelines for Not-So-Big Data, or why you may not need that shiny new data processing framework. And not because your data isn't big enough, but because sometimes you're not using all of that data and you may have simpler tools at your disposal. So that's me, my name's Akaash. I'm a web developer, and in some sense, my journey to closure started when I was building a small Ajax web client using _JS. I realize I may have dated myself with my reference to _JS, but I hope there are people here who remember using that old thing. Lodash version -1, I used to call it. I loved using it, and I didn't really know why at the time, until someone told me that it uses functional programming. So I Googled functional programming and found it to be just the right amount of weird to start using it in a lot of other places. This eventually led me to discovering Clojure, and that turned out to be the most enjoyably weird experience I've had programming in a while. So this brings us to my talk, which is actually about my team's experience using Clojure in a work project, because until then, I'd only used it for hobby projects. It's also about how we use plain old Clojure as a simpler, much more pain-free alternative to distributed data processing frameworks to handle some fairly sizable ETL workloads. So here's the talk outline. We'll start with a little bit of context about what my company does, the specific problem we were facing over there, all the iterations of the solutions that we came up with, some of the challenges we faced along the way, and finally, the lessons we learned. So I work for a company called Numbers, which is a financial technology startup. Without getting into too much detail, our product helps enterprises automate a lot of their processes around payments collections. For us to be able to do this, we need to pull data from the ERPs of these companies into our systems. I'm not sure how many people over here have had the good fortune of working with ERPs, but I believe the acronym stands for Endless Reservoirs of Pain. But they also go by Enterprise Resource Planning Systems, and are essentially these large, complicated systems that house a lot of the financial data of these companies. Our problem was that in order to extract data from these ERPs, we didn't really have the option of direct integrations with them. There are multiple reasons for this. For one, some of these ERPs are actually deployed on-premise, so they're just infrastructural obstacles to be able to access them. Sometimes they don't have APIs, sometimes they're not very great APIs, complicated legacy APIs. And a lot of the times, you also have licensing issues to grapple with, because as you add on an integration to that ERP, the licensing costs go up for that particular deployment. So we use the approach of extracting the data we needed from pre-existing canned reports, which are downloadable from these ERPs. These reports are usually spreadsheets available in a variety of different formats, and the format typically depends on the ERP vendor and the kind of customizations that have been done on it. Now, for the sort of data that we needed, usually a single report wouldn't cut it. So in a single run, it's not uncommon for us to process multiple such reports, and we end up having to process up to 1 million records in a single go. Also, another aspect that complicated this a little bit was the sort of transformations that we were applying on the data sets that we were reading. These were fairly compute-intensive, custom, complicated transformations. So the typical process for reading the data and onboarding the customer's data was you read the reports, you clean and massage the data, you transform these records, and then you write them to a destination file or database, standard ETL stuff. When evaluating the tech stack for this, there were some specific things we had in mind. We wanted good support for working with large spreadsheets. We also wanted to have expressive data transformations. We wanted support for processing reasonably large data sets on a single host, preferably in memory. We're also clear about some of the things we wanted to avoid. It's an obvious thing to say, but we wanted to avoid complexity, both in the form of the maintenance overhead that comes with deploying and maintaining your own data processing cluster, and also some of the incidental complexity that's inherent in certain tech stacks. For example, static typing, with all of its benefits, was something that we still wanted to avoid for this use case, purely because we didn't really have a comprehensive idea of the sort of data sets that we'd be processing, and we didn't want like a whole bunch of different data types in our code base. Also, we wanted to not go the proprietary route, and we wanted to avoid proprietary ETL solutions with high licensing costs. Now, given that we were a team that was doing a fair bit of Node.js and Golang before this, we also obviously evaluated those as alternatives. With Node, we found it to be not as performant when it was processing large data sets. And with Golang, amongst other things, we were missing the kind of expressive data transformations that we would get when using a functional programming language. So our search for a solution led us to evaluating Clojure. We got great support for processing Excel sheets, even large ones, from mature libraries in the Java ecosystem. And Clojure's Java interop made it a breeze for us to use this. In theory, features like lazy sequences, we thought would help us read large spreadsheets as data streams and keep the memory footprint low. Dynamic typing meant we could keep the number of type definitions low, and we wouldn't have to define new types for every new data set that was coming in. And of course, being a functional programming language, it gave us declarative data transformations. So Clojure was ticking a lot of the boxes that we had on our checklist, and so we decided to give it a try. When evaluating Clojure, or our POC in Clojure, we found that the first iteration needed to be simple, and we just wrote custom transformation scripts for each company we were trying to onboard. This naive version right off the bat gave us some decent benefits. We represented the transformations as linear pipelines using threading macros, which kept the code clean and readable. So we actually went from something that looked like this. I know it's not very legible, but that should give you an idea about how imperatively written the code was. This is a Node.js script. To something that structurally looked like this. Of course, there's an oversimplification. That's not the entire script, but it gives you an idea just from this tiny snippet about the structure of the script and exactly the sort of transformations that are going on. Now, despite some of the merits of this approach, it still had a few issues. For one, it was expensive. It required hand coding every part of the transformation and hence required a bit too much hands-on involvement of developers throughout the customer onboarding process. And given Clojure familiarity was low in the team, there were only a few of us who could help. Also, each of us were writing these scripts in our own separate ways, so there wasn't enough standardization. This was obviously a risk if we ever needed to revisit these scripts for incorporating enhancements or fixes. And we also found that in most of our real-world use cases, a single linear pipeline wasn't quite cutting it. Most of our transformations ended up being multiple such pipelines that needed to be composed together. And we were doing that in ad hoc imperative ways anyway, so that was compromising the readability that got us to using it anyways. So to overcome some of these issues, we moved to representing the transformations as directed acyclic graphs, or DAGs for short. I think Mayur in his talk spoke about them. These are graphs where the nodes are essentially connected by edges that have directions associated with them, and the edges never form a closed loop or cycle. Such a representation is similar to how certain workflow engines like Airflow and Oozy operate. It's also pretty typical of ETL solutions to structure their data flows like that. In such a DAG, each node in the graph would represent a single transformation operation, and the edges would represent how data flowed from one node into another. Composing multiple such nodes together in the right sequence would allow us to express complex transformations in a much more standardized form, and also move us to a more declarative format for defining these transformations. So for such an approach, the choice of Clojure actually proved to be quite astute, and this is where we got a fair bit of mileage out of our choice. We were able to accomplish this kind of DAG-style execution with a DSL that defined the DAGs declaratively using maps. So let's walk through an example that more closely resembles a real-world transformation. What you see on the screen is a DAG which has two main entry points, one which accepts a file containing open invoices, and one which accepts a file containing the billing details of closed invoices. Now, this is very typical of the sort of reports that we get, right? They're very specific in what they depict, and so we don't really have that much flexibility to change the reports themselves, and we have to combine a lot of them. So, as I said, you have a spreadsheet with open invoices and a spreadsheet with the billing details of closed invoices. The billing details are essentially line items of an invoice. So if in a purchase I have, let's say, stationery and toner ink, those would be the two billing details. And if you if you consolidate them, you basically end up with an invoice record, right? So for the open invoices, you pass the file, you read it, you clean and massage the data, and you have a list that is essentially a list of records where each record represents an invoice. And on the other hand, you have the billing details. So you read that file, you validate and clean those records, and you get a list of the billing details, which you then consolidate by grouping them by invoice ID. That gives you a list of all the closed invoices. So you have a list of the open invoices, a list of the closed invoices. You concatenate those two lists, and you get a list of all the invoices. Then you use this list for two separate purposes. One, you translate the list of invoices into a destination format that resembles the destination format that we expect. And secondly, you take the list and you also group it by customer ID to give you stats at a customer level, right? And that essentially gives you customer records. You then take these two lists and write them to a file, right? I hope I was able to do a half decent job of explaining that. So this is a definition of that DAG in our DSL. I know it's a fair bit to take in one glance, and let me just try to explain it. In this DSL, we incorporated support for around 12 different kinds of operations corresponding to 12 different kinds of nodes. So the entire flow is represented as a map where each key value pair defines a node, the operation that you're performing in the node, and the dependencies of that node. So some of these operations, for example, reading and writing files, concatenating or aggregating lists, could be represented completely through configuration. So as you can see from some of the code examples there, there's actually not much code over there. It's mostly just data. But some of the others, for example, mapping and filtering, required us to write code, if only for the iterative functions that were required for such transformations. We also provided an escape hatch in the form of a custom node type, which allowed us to introduce arbitrary code for anything that couldn't be accomplished with the default set of operations that were supported in our DSL. So using this DAG definition, we were actually also able to generate documentation for our transformations. What you see on the screen is a diagram that we generated using the same definition that I just showed you and walked you through. The elliptical nodes in this diagram symbolize the input arguments, and the rectangular nodes represent the actual data processing operation. So you can follow along as a developer and understand exactly what each script does. And this makes it a lot easier if you have to ever revisit it or if a separate developer needs to be handed off the script. So this was helpful because it reduced the amount of code that we needed to write and moved us in a more declarative direction. One of the benefits of being more declarative was obviously that we were able to generate diagrams, as I just showed you. But also, it moved us in a direction where we possibly be able to express these transformations with a UI that business users could eventually use. On the flip side, this wasn't as readable as what we got with the threading macros, but that was an acceptable compromise to us. Also, it had a higher memory footprint than the custom scripts, but it still worked on a single machine with our data sets, and that was good enough for us. So in the next iteration, we'd like to be able to serialize these DAG definitions and persist them to a database. What I didn't actually mention just now was that most of these definitions are static compile time definitions expressed through a macro that we'd written. So today, we end up requiring code changes every time we want to deploy a new transformer. In the future, we'd like to be able to dynamically add and modify transformers. We also want to get to a more declarative expression of operations like mapping and filtering, so that we can realize our final vision of having business users design these transformations themselves without any involvement from development teams. Also, we've realized of late that some of the reports that come in tend to have changes in them which we didn't quite expect. So while we can't expect transformers to handle changes like an extra column being added or a new financial data entry type being introduced, we should try and ensure that these new changes or these new data sets don't really fail silently or result in incorrect mappings in the system. So we're looking to express these kind of business validation rules using closure spec in future versions. And in the absence of static types, it gives us a very compelling alternative to express some of the expectations that we have of the data and ensure some correctness in the process. Right, so we obviously faced a few challenges along the way. the primary one being the closure learning curve. It's definitely a thing. And I know the tagline reads simple made easy, but I'd probably change it to something around the lines of simple made pretty easy, but sometimes a little difficult, but still quite worth it. But what do I know? As you can tell, copywriting isn't my strong suit. And the stack traces. Oh, those sweet, sweet stack traces. As beginners, especially working on lazy sequences and macros, it wasn't the easiest thing to come to grips with, especially because it's not very apparent where the error has really occurred and what caused it. Also, there seems to be low convergence within the community on de facto libraries and frameworks. Some experienced closure devs didn't agree with me when I said this, but it certainly felt like the case to us who were more on the outside looking in. And nowhere was this fragmentation more intensely felt than when we tried to self-identify as Clojure developers and didn't know whether to call ourselves Clojurians or Clojurists. So if there's one thing that I want to come out of my visit to this conference, it is an answer to this question. So if you have any opinions over there, please find me and let me know. In conclusion, we chose to trade off the scalability of a distributed data processing platform for the simplicity and predictability of a single machine setup. After a lot of deliberation, we found that Clojure's features fit very well for our problem space, and the choice of it has been working out well for us so far. And I'd imagine that this probably also holds true for a lot of other ETL workloads where the data sets aren't as large to warrant big data solutions. So if your use case qualifies for that, I definitely recommend Clojure for it. I'd like to end by referencing this quote from my favorite TV show, The Wire. In it, you have the guy on the left, Proposition Joe, advising the guy on the right, Stringer Bell, about how drug dealers can be very successful when they keep their business boring and avoid too much flash. Now, I'm not saying programmers have a lot in common with drug dealers, but both of us do tend to refer to our users, our customers as users, and we are in the business of providing them with product and fixes, so you tell me. But I think there's a lot of value in even programmers keeping their daily lives boring sometimes. Because even though you may feel like reaching for that fancy new data processing framework that everyone's talking about, sometimes it's wise to ask yourselves whether you really need it and whether there are simpler options at your disposal, even if that does involve some trade-offs. Thank you.